Dr. J. Richards has a PhD with honors in philosophy and theology from Princeton Theological Seminary. He also has a Master of Divinity, Master of Theology, and a BA with majors in political science and religion. He is the author of many books, including the New York Times bestsellers Infiltrated and Indivisible. He is also the author of Money, Greed, and God, winner of a 2010 Templeton Enterprise Award. He has co-authored The Privileged Planet with astronomer Guillermo Gonzalez and The Hobbit Party with Jonathan Witt. His much-anticipated book, The Human Advantage, The Future of American Work in an Age of Smart Machines, is coming out in June. Dr. Richards is a professor in the Bush School of Business and Economics at the Catholic University of America, a senior fellow at the Discovery Institute, and an executive editor of The Stream. In recent years, he has been distinguished fellow at the Institute for Faith, Work, and Economics, contributing editor at the American Enterprise Institute, a visiting fellow at the Heritage Foundation, and a research fellow and director of Acton Media at the Acton Institute. Dr. Richards' articles and essays have been published in the Harvard Business Review, Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, Forbes, and numerous other journals, newspapers, and magazines. His topics range from culture, economics, and public policy to natural science, technology, and the environment. He is also creator and executive producer of several documentaries, including three that appeared widely on PBS, The Call of the Entrepreneur, The Birth of Freedom, and The Privileged Planet. Dr. Richards has appeared on several hundred radio and television programs, including Larry King Live on CNN, Fox and Friends, and PBS. He has lectured at dozens of college campuses, think tanks, and conferences, and has spoken to members of the U.S. Congress and congressional staff. Dr. Richards lives in Virginia with his wife and two daughters, one of whom is a good friend of mine. As you can see, Dr. Richards is a very influential man, almost too influential, since recently he convinced my mom to try the ketogenic diet, a form of low-carb cooking he recommended. Unfortunately, this caused lots of protests in my family, since we love pasta and potatoes.
Sorry.
Thanks, Dr. Richards.
Sorry about that.
Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richards.
Okay. Sorry about that low-carb thing. I didn't realize that. Well, it's great to be with you tonight, and I want to give you a sense of what I want you to take away from this, because I know it's very likely you're going to miss and forget a lot of the details. If you're checking your cell phone, you'll miss even the broadest details. So here's the takeaway, all right? So I want you to have an understanding of how ethics and economics relate. How does the question, I'm a Catholic, I teach at Catholic University, I think that we should be concerned about our fellow human beings. I believe in something called solidarity, which means that I have responsibility for people that are near me. And I have more responsibility for the people that are near me than for those far away that I don't know anything about. So that means if someone, my neighbor, is hurting, for instance, he's lost his job, he doesn't have enough money to pay his rent or to feed his children, that I accept that as a moral responsibility that I ought to do something if he asks me to help. That's a moral obligation, all right? I think there's kind of a broad moral obligation we have to our fellow Americans, right? Some of us are better off than others. The question is, how do you best help people? How do you best help your neighbor? How do you best help someone that's an American, but that you don't know personally? That is the difficult question. And if you're a Christian, if you're Catholic, if you're a religious person at all, this is a question that you either are dealing with or you'll have to deal with. If you are a college student or will become a college student, I promise you that many of your professors will have very strong opinions about this, and they won't be careful at distinguishing between our obligations and what we ought to do to actually help people. In order to do that, you actually have to know something about the so-called dismal science. That's economics. Now, the reason there's a specific historical reason it's called the dismal science. Have any of you had an econ course, either in high school or in college? So it's still a minority of you. Most of you, anyone that's in high school, how many high schoolers that have had an econ course? Okay, that's a good number. And how many of those were homeschooled and got it as homeschoolers? So a few of you, okay. So some of you had regular high school econ course. That's probably the best econ course you'll ever have, I hate to tell you. When you get to college, you'll get a course probably called macroeconomics, is usually the first course that students are thrown into. And macroeconomics is designed to turn you off from the discipline of economics so that you'll do something else. I mean, it's not literally true, but there's something about economics that's so counterintuitive. It tends to be formal. It tends to be mathematical. It doesn't tend to deal with the things that you think economics ought to be about. And so you end up missing the kind of amazing intellectual beauty and satisfaction of what we'll call the economic way of thinking. So what I want you to do is I want these categories to be in your mind. First, a way of thinking which you can learn from economics that will help you to think through problems so that you actually have something you can say and some set of tools you can use in order to say, okay, let's think about how actually best to help this person rather than just resting satisfied with our moral platitudes. So you get a set of tools. And then I also want you to think about a domain of reality that we're going to call the economy. All right, so in other words, there's intellectual disciplines like math or chemistry or economics, but there's also that sphere of the world that it's supposed to study. You know what I'm talking about? So there's chemistry. I took chemistry first in the seventh grade, had to memorize the periodic table of the elements, forgot it in the eighth grade, right? But I learned it. And the chemistry is a great discipline because it's really well understood. The periodic table of the elements is filled in. There are no sort of missing elements. You know, there was a time when there were elements that were theorized, like helium, that hadn't actually been discovered. So chemistry is a very well understood science, and it studies a particular narrow range of the physical world that we call chemistry, all right? Now there's another field in the human sciences, or the natural sciences, called economics. And so economics, when it works well, when it's a good course, and you're being taught it by a good professor or a good teacher, will give you a set of intellectual tools, sort of ways of thinking, and actually some categories. And if it's a good course, those tools and categories will allow you to understand this domain of reality. So that just as the chemical realm has particular principles and rules that you can discover and do chemical reactions, and you can calculate what kinds of reactions you're going to get based on elements forming compounds, so in economics. If you know that supply and demand are generally inversely related and that prices perform a function, then you'll be able to figure out what's going to happen if we raise the federal minimum wage to $200 an hour. You'll be able to figure out ahead of time and predict what's going to happen because you understand something about that sphere of reality. Does that make sense? So a set of tools that will allow you to understand a particular sphere. So what is that economic sphere? You know what the chemical realm would be. It would be something about physical matter, right? The stuff that's built up, it's sort of between physics and biology, and it's described formally with the periodic table of the elements. So you got that. What is the economic sphere? What's that realm? Just think about it for a minute. This is difficult. There's not a physical location. We don't have an economic periodic table of the elements. It's something like this. It's that social domain in which individuals, as human beings, communities, states, and firms buy, sell, and exchange goods, services, and information in the context of scarcity. Right? It's a long definition. But what I want you to remember is that this is a social realm. It's something that it emerges only when people interact in certain ways, when we start trading, when we start producing stuff, we take materials and we turn them into technologies and we trade them for something else. Then all of a sudden there's this new social realm that didn't exist before, that wouldn't exist, right, if we were all just hunter-gatherers living in cages and hunting our food and otherwise trading. Well, what's surprising to people is that once you have a lot of people doing this so that you can actually study different economic systems, rules emerge that nobody would have guessed. So even 200 years ago, for instance, we didn't actually know what would happen if a government decided it was going to dictate the prices of everything, as the Soviet Union did. When the Soviet Union abolished private property after the October Revolution in 1917, they abolished private property, they collectivized all the farms, so all the peasantry were suddenly essentially employees of the state, abolished the price system, and dictated quotas for manufacturing and food. Now, there were some smart guys in Austria at the time that predicted what was going to happen, but we didn't actually know what was going to happen because nobody had done it. What happened is about 3 million people died in a couple of short years. just entirely because it screwed up the economic system and there are massive shortages. Grain got wasted in warehouses rather than getting shipped to cities. But anyone that understood economics could have said ahead of time, that's going to be a disaster. And with just a little study and a little reading and a little thinking, you can learn to do that too. The reason I actually got involved in this is because I'm actually a philosopher. I don't even play an economist on TV. I'm a philosopher that's very interested in how economics and ethics and morality intersect. And I frankly, out of frustration more than anything else, because I thought a lot of well-meaning people, a lot of well-meaning Catholics wanted to help people, but actually supported economic ideas that harmed rather than helping people. And so that's honestly, out of frustration more than anything else, is why I got into this. And so what I want to describe for you here for a few minutes tonight is 4 of 8 myths that I think are essentially, they're kind of intellectual speed bumps that prevent us from thinking clearly about economics and economic issues. Because a lot of economics, it ought to be commonsensical and it ought to be intuitive, but it's not. And it's usually because we've got some bad idea in our minds that we're applying to the problem, and it confuses us, so we end up supporting something completely harmful. So this is why well-meaning Catholics, for instance, can end up supporting economic policies that actually harm poor people. It's not because they want to do that. It's because they've got a distorted understanding of what economic reality is like. So I can't talk about all of these 8 myths. If you are curious, though, you can look them up online. They're in this book called Money, Greed, and God. I can't describe all of them, but I wanted to give you kind of the 4 big myths so that you get an idea of the kind of ways in which we can confuse our economic thinking and so not understand this reality that I'm describing. First is what I call the piety myth. Now, piety is just, that just describes the state of your heart. So your piety has to do with the way you feel and are oriented toward other human beings and toward God. So if you're a pious person, then you're a noble person, you're a good person, who the state of your heart is right. The piety myth is confusing what you intend to do with the actual consequences of your action. Those are 2 different things, obviously, right? What I want to do and what actually happens as a result of my action are 2 different things. But we're often tempted to just say, well, I should get points for meaning to do well. And if you focus on that, especially when it comes to economic policy, you know, the what a member of Congress meant to do doesn't actually change what the policy is actually going to do to people, right? So let's take that minimum wage idea again. Let's say all the members of Congress decide we're going to raise the minimum wage to $200 an hour. Now, does it matter why members of Congress did that? Like, did they mean to help people or hurt people? I mean, is that going to affect what it actually does? No, the policy is going to have whatever effects it's going to have, whatever the well-meaning kind of desires of the members of Congress. So if you can learn simply to distinguish what you mean to do from what actually happens, you're half the way there. In fact, there's a great book by a guy named Henry Hazlitt, written in the 1950s, called Economics in One Lesson. And this is actually how he describes, at the beginning of the book, what he calls the art of economics. So not the science of economics. Let's assume there's a science to economics. An art is really something that you kind of get down in your bones intuitively. So if you're a great sculptor, for instance, you first spend a couple of years learning the basic principles of sculpting, but once you're a really good sculptor, that becomes who you are, and then you express it, right, implicitly. The art of economics, in a sense, you have to first by learning the rules, but then it just becomes a part of who you are as a thinker. Here's what Hazlitt said. He said, the art of economics consists in looking not merely at the immediate, but at the longer effects of any act or policy. It consists in tracing the consequences of that policy, not merely for one group, but for all groups. In other words, if you can master the art of simply asking a single question, you will have mastered the art of economics. What's that question? And then what will happen? That's it. So your friend, you're lying awake at night, and your friend is spending the night, and she's saying, you know, it'd be really nice if we raised the minimum wage to $100 an hour. It'd be really nice if the government just paid everybody $30,000 a year, and then no one would be poor. Now, you could say, gosh, you're so nice, you want to help people. But you've mastered the art of economics, so what are you going to say to your friend? And then what will happen, right? Not complicated, right? Yeah, we're done, all right? That's it. That's literally it. Now, the reason that this is so useful is that we actually know what's going to happen. There's no economic idea that anybody is going to have that hasn't actually been tried and either succeeded or failed, and the knowledge of it is available with one Google click. That's the great time about the moment in which we live. Every terrible idea has been tried in economics, and so we've got the data. But what we normally don't do if we believe the piety myth is we don't think, oh, I need to focus on what's actually going to happen to people. I thought I got the box checked just by meaning to do well. But the problem is that people usually assume that the idea of what they want to have happen is what's actually going to happen. And the reason they think that is they don't understand that, no, actually that economic realm, that sphere of reality, it has its own rules and principles. So members of Congress actually don't have control over whether supply and demand are inversely related. They can't make a law that changes that. They can only make laws that either recognize that or don't. Right? And your friend doesn't have the ability, for instance, for everyone to simply prosper, right? She could, you know, we could sort of run out the logic of a particular policy and see what's actually going to happen. Now, we could spend all night giving examples of what happens when people believe the piety myth. I'll just give you one. It's a nice, clear example. Only takes about 5 minutes to explain. It's called rent control. I don't know if any of you live in cities where rent control exists. Rent control doesn't exist in a pure form really anywhere anymore, but in the 1960s and 1970s it did. And the reason is because it's a disaster when it's tried. But if you live in Manhattan, for instance, do you live somewhere?
I live in Manhattan.
Oh, you live in Manhattan. Okay, so there you go. So rent control is, it's like a weird series of things that happens. And what it does is it generally encourages people who are in apartments and are under rent control, they don't want to leave the apartment, basically, because then it kicks into the sort of market price. So let me tell you the basic idea of rent control. So in the 1960s and 1970s, especially around the world, people started noticing city councils that, you know, there's not a whole lot of housing. There's a lot of people that want to live here, and there's a limited amount of space. And so that causes the price of rents to go up, right? So this is supply and demand. Limited supply increases the demand. Going to raise the price. And city councils thought, you know, this is going to make it impossible for lower income people to live here. They're not going to be able to afford rent. What are we going to do? And globally, city councils thought, well, what we'll do is we'll put a ceiling on how much landlords can charge for rent. All right, so now what's their intention? Why would you do that? We'd say, let's make it illegal for a landlord to charge more than $400 a month for one bedroom apartments. All right, so what, anyone guess, why would a city council do that? What would they want to be to have happen? Right? Why? Why would they want to keep rent, create a law like this? Is it to torment people? No.
People can have housing.
Right. So people, lower income people can have housing. So people that can't afford housing that costs more than $400 a month will have housing. Right. So their intentions presumably would actually help lower income people. Now I want you to think about this. I want you to use your own powers of reasoning. That's what city councils want to have happen. Try to figure out what actually happens whenever this is tried. And you will figure it out if you look at it from the perspective of the landlord. All right, so let's say you own a 10-story apartment complex. It's nothing but one-bedroom apartments. All right, so you have to maintain these. You probably have to pay your mortgage on it unless you own it outright. You have to pay taxes. You have to keep it maintained for a certain to a certain level or the city will condemn it. Right, all these kinds of things. It costs you money to maintain that property. Now imagine that you have these one-bedroom apartments in this apartment complex and it costs you $800 a month just to maintain them, whether anyone's living there or not. All right? Now the city has just told you you are only legally allowed to charge $400 a month in rent. So right off the bat, you're going to be losing $400 a month on your rental property per unit. All right? So unless you're into torturing yourself and going broke, you're in a problem. Right, so now imagine what landlords in this situation actually do. Think about this. They just say, well, okay, I guess I'm just going to go broke. No, they're going to try not to go broke. And so there's about one of three things happens. The first one is that you will sell the complex as condominiums. So you can convert it from rental property to condominium property, which people buy. And then it's not rented, so it's not under rent control. This happened to my wife and me when we first lived in Seattle. The apartment we were in was converted to condos and we couldn't afford it. We had to move out, right? So think about that. So there's this bunch of apartment houses or complexes that suddenly become condominiums, right? Under rent control. The second thing you can do is you can turn it into a commercial property. So instead of renting it as apartments, you can make it a warehouse. You could make it stores or restaurants, or maybe you turn it into a parking garage. So again, it's not rental property. So then you can recoup your cost. Third thing you could do is try to cut your costs by not maintaining the property, right? So it becomes unsafe. That might work for a year or two, but you're then actually violating code, and eventually the property gets condemned, and then people have to move out. So what is the effect in all three cases? Some are sold as condos, some are converted to stores and warehouses, and some end up condemned. Have you increased the supply of rental property? No. So what they wanted to do is increase the amount of affordable rental property, and the effect is exactly the opposite, to create a shortage of rental property. Now think about these other landlords. Think about developers in New Jersey that are wanting to invest in new rental property in Manhattan. Are they going to do it? No, of course not. So you're going to get a near-term, a medium-term, and a long-term shortage in just the range of housing that you're trying to preserve. Now, is this going to affect multi-million dollar brownstones in Central Park East? No. It's going to affect that range of rental property that you were trying to protect. Now, why does that happen? Does it happen because all city councils are mean and want to hurt poor people? Of course not. It happens because of supply and demand. It's just a fundamental principle of economics. And so in other words, city councils worldwide didn't manage to remember the first lesson you learn in Econ 101, supply and demand and the function of prices. But if you remember this, if you remember not to believe the piety myth and to ask that one question, hopefully as a city council person later, you won't make that mistake. All right, so that's the piety myth. Second one's what we'll call the greed myth. Now the greed myth is not the idea that some people are greedy. It's not even the idea that lots of people are greedy. We're a fallen race. People do all sorts of vicious things for all sorts of reasons. The idea of the greed myth, though, is the claim that capitalism or the market economy is in essence about greed and selfishness. Right? So you see the distinction? So of course people are greedy in certain contexts, not always and not everything that we do. That's not a myth. But the idea of the essence of capitalism is about greed. That's the greed myth. Now this is a really, really pervasive idea, and I would like to tell you that this is only sort of proposed by critics of capitalism. I don't know if any of you have seen the 1987 movie Wall Street with Michael Douglas, which was made into a sequel about 4 years ago. So some of the, probably two of the oldest guys in the room here, we've seen it. Okay, you've seen it. Right, so it's about this guy played by Michael Douglas named Gordon Gekko. And he's a really, really, kind of stereotypical coarse cigar smoking Wall Street real estate trader type with the white collar, you know, they always have those. And he gives this famous greed is good speech near the end. It's supposed to be the climax of the movie. It's not especially inspiring. But when I saw it, I thought, well, of course, this is made by Oliver Stone. He's a well-known leftist. He's kind of very anti-American. Of course, he's going to create a character like this. Unfortunately, probably the most widely read defender of the free economy in the 20th century made an argument very much like this, Ayn Rand. I don't know how many of you know who she is or have read her. I didn't read her until I was in college. I had a sort of 6-month infatuation with Atlas Shrugged. It's a very long book that I don't really recommend it unless you are supposed to be studying for a German final or something, then you might try it. But Rand is, again, she's about 300,000 copies of her books sell every year. She was an exile from the Soviet Union that moved to the US in the 20s, ended up in California sort of as a writer and a playwright, wrote a book called The Fountainhead, and then in 1957 wrote her sort of magnum opus called Atlas Shrugged. And so she was a hardcore critic of socialism, especially Soviet socialism, and a defender of what she called capitalism. But she had a kind of quirky way of making the case. She was a really hostile, kind of anti-Christian atheist who actually blamed Christianity for socialism. She thought, well, Christianity elevated the idea of altruism in which we care about our fellow human beings. And that's where socialists got that idea. And socialism's evil, therefore Christianity must be evil. That was sort of her argument. And in fact, she even wrote a book called The Virtue of Selfishness. Right? Of course, she knows that one of the seven deadly sins is greed or selfishness. But rather than calling it a vice, she calls it a virtue. Right? Now, this is a very strange thing. I first read her, as I said, in college, and I had a stint as a Christian socialist, my freshman and part of my sophomore year in college. But I kept reading economics. I read Thomas Sowell and people like that. Finally, by my senior year, I was convinced, actually, I think free enterprise is the best economic system of the ones going. There just aren't better live alternatives. But then I read Ayn Rand, this hardcore defender of capitalism, and she told me, this is what she says in this book. She said, capitalism and altruism are philosophical opposites. They cannot coexist in the same man or in the same society. Capitalism and altruism are philosophical opposites. Right, now, if you look up altruism in the dictionary, you're going to discover it comes from the Latin word alter, which means other. So altruism is acting for the benefit of another person. Right? So, and I knew that as a senior in college. This is very, very strange for her to say this, especially because I thought if we're looking at the kind of economic systems that actually help people, that allow people to emerge from poverty, it's the market economy. So if the essence of it is greed, I think that's going to be a problem. It was certainly going to be a problem for me as a Catholic, as a Christian at the time and a Catholic later. So I became a Catholic about 9 years ago and was evangelical before that. So this, I struggled with this problem. I finally realized I think Rand doesn't quite have this argument right. First of all, it turns out she defined altruism weirdly. In fact, she defines almost every term weirdly. So what did I tell you altruism was? It's acting for the benefit of the other. Rand defined altruism as acting for the benefit of the other at your own expense. Right? So you have to be harming yourself when you benefit someone else. Okay, well, now that's different. That's not altruism, that's self-sacrifice or something like that. That's a different sort of thing. There's lots of altruistic acts that help someone and also help yourself. In fact, that turns out what happens in market economies. She had just slightly distorted the case, and this is where she ended up. Now, a lot of people think, well, this has always been sort of the argument for capitalism from the very beginning. In fact, didn't Adam Smith, the sort of founder of modern economics, isn't this his argument? Now, I won't ask you how many of you have read Smith's Wealth of Nations. It's a very long, somewhat tedious book. A few of you have, okay. It's a very long book written in 1776. Adam Smith was a Scottish moral philosopher. This is the only existing picture of him right here. He burned all of his effects and papers at the end of his life. Very frustrating for Smith scholars. But his most influential book is this book, The Wealth of Nations. And it's a book written to critique what was called mercantilism at the time. So the British Empire basically had tried to control the trade within its empire and between the countries in its empire and other states, right? So kind of like a cronyism these days in which you don't allow sort of free trade among peoples and countries. And he was critiquing it and saying, actually, that's not the way that, countries and nations become wealthy. And so the book was all about this. And so he describes pin factories and a lot of somewhat tedious stuff. But what he's well known for is actually two ideas. One is everyone attaches him, he's the one that said that everyone should pursue their own self-interest and then everything will work out really well. And people often connect him with this one other idea, which is that the market is an invisible hand. How many of you have heard that metaphor? Market, a bunch of you. It turns out in all Smith's writings, I've ever been able to find it only used in two places. So it's not actually a major part of his thinking. But a lot of people read Smith after having read Ayn Rand, and they read Rand back into Smith. And when you do that, you completely mess up what he was arguing. Now, Smith has an amazing argument about self-interest and greed. It's going to take me about 5 minutes to unpack it for you. So this is the point at which I'm going to slice the bologna a little thinner. But if you stay with me for this for 5 minutes, it's simple stuff all the rest of the way, all right? What I want you to see is that Adam Smith makes a very important argument about the market that's totally different from the one that Ayn Rand made. So let me give you just two famous quotes. These are sort of the two things that people that have heard of Adam Smith know of. Now, Smith, incidentally, was a Scottish moral philosopher. So this is 1776 when he writes this book. There's not a discipline called economics. Economics emerged from moral philosophy. It only really became its own discipline in the late 19th century. All right, so he's a moral philosopher. His first book was actually, it was called The Theory of Moral Sentiments. He was trying to account for how we develop natural sympathies for our fellow human beings. And then he wrote this other very large book some years later. So here's one of many times he says something like this. He said, it's not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own interest. So in other words, it's not that the butcher is visualizing world peace or just thinking how much he loves you. That's not, you know, that's not the source of him providing meat for you. It's something else. It's from his regard to his own interest. Now, is he saying greed is good? Is he saying the butcher ought to be greedy? Is he saying Selfishness is a virtue. No, he's not. So hold that quote in your mind, all right? I'm going to give you a quote, one of the two places where he uses the invisible hand, all right? He's talking about what he calls men of commerce here. He said, in spite of their natural selfishness and rapacity, business people are led by an invisible hand, and thus without intending it, without knowing it, advance the interest of the society. All right, so I want you to remember these two quotes. Now, what's he saying? There's several, I told you I'm gonna have to slice the bologna a little thinner here. I want you to make a few distinctions. There's a difference between self-interest and selfishness. Every time you take a breath, every time you brush your teeth, do your homework, look both ways before you cross the streets, take your vitamins, obey your parents, obey your teachers, you're acting in your self-interest. Is that a bad thing? Is that sort of a necessary evil? Well, you gotta breathe, but you know, it's unfortunate, but you do have to breathe, you have to eat. No, in fact, I can tell you as a parent of high schoolers and now one college student, you spend 18 years trying to teach your kids what their self-interest is. You know, just brush your teeth. Just put your shoes on before you go outside. Really basic things. This is how God made us. We are physical creatures. We have bodies. We take up space. We breathe air. We have to drink water. We have to eat food, right? And so our self-interest principally and initially is just that domain of our interest, the stuff we're concerned about, right? And as physical creatures, right, that we have to act in some sense in our self-interest a lot of the time. Part of it is because we know our interests better than anyone else does. Imagine if you relied for someone at the Department of Health and Human Services to tell you when to drink water or to breathe. Would that be an efficient system? No, it's a disaster, right? So if you're a functioning person and you're an adult, you're the one that's likely to know what basic things you are that you need. If you're a parent of small children, you're gonna know better than your neighbor or the president what your children need. So that's self-interest. It's just that narrow jurisdiction over which you have some control and over which you have concerns. And so initially Smith's argument about the butcher, it's not that he's saying the butcher ought to be greedy and then, you know, good will result. What he's saying is that the butcher may just be thinking about the fact that his daughter needs braces and he's got to pay the rent and he's not making enough money. That he could just be thinking about the thing that motivates him most, what he cares about. But in a market economy where you have the rule of law, he can't steal from his neighbor, he can't force you to buy his meat, and if he sells you rotten meat, you're gonna put a negative review on Yelp. So what's the butcher going to do in order to get his daughter braces and to pay the rent? He's gonna try to provide you the best meat at the cheapest price and to do it better than his competitors. In other words, focusing on his self-interest plus a market in the natural law will channel his activities into things that benefit you as a customer, even if he's not really thinking about you in particular. He's thinking about you in general. He's saying, what do customers like? But he doesn't have to be thinking about how much he loves every customer that comes in the door. He can just be focused on needing to pay the rent and get his daughter braces. Do you understand that? That's Smith's point. Is it a market economy? This is not the rule of nature, right? This is not the law of the jungle. This is not the anarchy, like the Lord of the Flies. This is a market economy. He's picturing a, you know, certain 1700s Scotland, right? A market in Edinburgh or Glasgow or something like that, in which people basically don't steal, right? There are people competing, other butchers that you can, where you can shop, right? And then they're gonna be these butchers that have their own interest. And so his point is, if you got a system like that with rule of law and then economic freedom, people in the market are gonna actually find ways of exchanging things. So it's gonna try to serve each other, even when they're focusing on the things other than what maybe their customer is interested in. So in other words, a market economy channels even your narrowest self-interest. Now, there's the second point though. Remember the previous quote. Says, in spite of their natural selfishness and rapacity. He also recognizes that business people, like everyone else, are sometimes selfish and rapacious. In fact, Smith says things like, you never do two or three business people gather together, but that they try to conspire against their fellow human beings and control prices. So he actually has a kind of Calvinist view of human nature in general. So his point is, a market economy channels our legitimate self-interest. And even if the butcher is really just greedy, Let's say the butcher isn't just thinking about paying the rent. He just wants to run his competitors out of business and make as much money as he can, and he's focused just on that. What's the best way that the butcher can fulfill his greed in a market economy with the rule of law? It's to outcompete, right, the other people selling meat. In other words, to serve customers better than his competitors. Smith's point is not that greed is good, not that a market economy requires greed or needs greed or feeds greed. It's that a market economy is best able to channel your legitimate self-interest, your ingenuity, and even your greed and self-interest into ways that benefit other people in a market, and to do it much better than other economic systems. Socialism, for instance. In a socialist economy, you go to a store, if any of you have ever been to even a semi-socialist country, you go into markets that are semi-state run, they could care less about serving you because they're getting paid more or less the same either way. Right? So they're not competing. They're not worried about serving the customer. The main incentive is to curry favor with the government and the regulators, not to serve customers, to be in the pay and to be bribing the regulators and the government. Totally different set of incentives. Does that make sense? All right, so that's, I promise you, the most complicated point. So if you forget everything else, remember there's a distinction between selfishness and self-interest. And remember that Smith's point is not Rand's point. Ayn Rand said greed is good, selfishness is a virtue. Smith said you want an economic system that can channel both our basic needs and even our selfishness in ways that actually help people. All right, that's the third myth, and this, I promise you, is much, much simpler. What we'll call the zero-sum game myth. Think of the zero-sum game myth as a myth about the nature of trade. All right, so those of you probably don't remember this because it's now been almost 8 years since the financial crisis, so some of you are probably in elementary school, but there was an event after the financial crisis in 2008. There's a little park called Zuccotti Park in Lower Manhattan, close to Wall Street, and several hundred people camped out there. It was called Occupy Wall Street, and this is a picture from that. And nothing actually became of these big protests. There were crimes committed, and everybody kind of left. But for several months, there were people camped out in this little park. And the park's tiny. It's about the two of these rooms, probably. But if you have 400 cameras, it looks like half the world is protesting. But they introduced this distinction to the American lexicon, the difference between the 1% and the 99%. So the idea was that all these guys trading these mortgage-backed securities and mortgage securities, they're the 1% who have confiscated all the wealth for themselves and left 99% of us, the rest of us, I guess, sort of in destitute poverty. Now, if you looked at people actually protesting, for the most part, they weren't actually really poor people. I remember one of the guys that was a spokesman for Occupy Wall Street had a master's degree from a state university in Illinois. I think he may have been the same guy that was mad about his student loans for puppetry. He had done a master's degree, apparently, in puppetry, and was, I guess, upset that he couldn't make six figures on this. I mean, so this is what he did for a few months. But they introduced this idea. It didn't make any kind of policy difference, but it introduced the idea that the economy in that case was a zero-sum game. And a zero-sum game is just a game in which if one person wins, somebody else has to lose. You think of it as a win-lose game. It's called a zero-sum game because it just means that if you play the game, it's like 1 + -1 = 0. And so most of the games we play are actually like this. I mean, the games. So chess, checkers, baseball, football, soccer, hockey. Some of these games you can tie. But notice when there's a tie, there's no winner. If there's a draw in chess, there's no winner. To have a winner in any of these games, you have to have a loser. That's a win-loser zero-sum game. Right? So that's a type of game. This term is drawn from a field called game theory. So a lot of people assume either that the economy domestically or the international trade is a zero-sum game. So if somebody's benefiting, somebody else is being punished. That guy got rich. If he has an extra dollar, he took the dollar from somebody else. That's just the way it works. Now, most of us know that can't quite be right, but it's very easy to fall for this idea intuitively because it seems like it sort of could be right. So the question is, I want you to just apply this right now to trade, all right? And assume the zero-sum game myth is about trading, either between individuals or between people in different countries or whatever. But I want you to, you need three categories to get this, all right? So you've got a zero-sum or win-lose game, so that's one winner and one loser. All right, so there are two other logical possibilities here. This one is zero sum, winner, loser. Second possibility, loser, loser. All right, so that's a lose-lose game. A lose-lose game is a game in which the people playing it all end up worse off as a result of having played it. Right, now you don't have to all end up equally bad off, but if everyone that plays ends up worse off, that's a lose-lose game. Do any of us play lose-lose games? I mean, is it just a logical possibility?
Russian roulette.
Russian roulette, nuclear war in a confined space. Yeah, exactly. So you don't play these very many times. So these people that play them select themselves out of the gene pool, obviously, right? So win, lose, lose, lose. And there's a third possibility here. Win, win. All right, now what's a win-win game? A win-win game is a game in which everyone that plays ends up better off than they were if they hadn't played. Now, it doesn't have to be a game in which everyone ends up equally well off. That's nice, but it's a win-win game if everyone is better off as a result of having played it. So to determine if a game is win-win, you don't compare yourself to some other person that's playing it. You compare yourself having played the game with your counterfactual self if you hadn't played the game. Right, so imagine you go to some pre-wedding party and the groom is very wealthy and it's sort of like a casino night. And he's got a craps table set up and a roulette wheel and he's got checkers and blackjack and everything, but he's rigged the decks so that anyone that plays for about a half an hour or more is bound to end up with more, at least as much money as when they came in. He gives everybody $10 in chips. Right, at the end of the night, some people leave with $11, some with $100, some with $1,000, some with $10,000. No one ends up with less. So that's a win-win game. Now, if you're one of the ones that won $11, you're going to be mad you didn't make $10,000. But that doesn't mean it wasn't a win-win game. It just means you're selfish, right? I mean, of course you're going to be that way. My wife and I rented a house one time south of Seattle. We were in transition. And we were in a little house across the street. And on the other side of the street, there's an amazing view of this valley. And so the houses across the street cost about five times as much as the house where we were. And the guy across the street from us had an orange Lamborghini, all right? And I was irritated. I was like, he's not that smart. Why is he driving a Lamborghini? I was driving a Passat, gray Passat, with a scrape on the side, right? And then I realized I was working on the book at the time. I thought, oh, you know, actually, I'm driving a Volkswagen, right? That's what I ought to be focusing on, and not the fact that some guy has a Lamborghini. He didn't cause me to be poor, right, by having a Lamborghini. But that's the fallen human mentality. But what you want to know is, are there economic arrangements where people that play it long-term end up better off, even if some people end up better off than others? That's the question. Are there arrangements that are like that? Well, as it happens, I knew the answer to this question in the sixth grade. I didn't figure it out for several decades because I missed the point of the lesson. So I'm in the sixth grade. I grew up in a part of Texas that was mostly hot, but for periodic ice storms, which you knew were coming the day before. And we didn't have snow days for some reason. I never had a snow day my whole childhood. But if it iced over or snowed, you would just get trapped inside for the day, no recesses. And so the teacher, in this case, I guess had seen what was coming. So she went to the dollar store, bought a bunch of toys, and brought them in. And then during our long midday recess, she had us pass out these little toys one by one so that each of us had a toy. There was a set of Barbie trading cards, a paddle ball, silly putty egg, you know, the kind of typical stuff. All different. Everybody had something different, but you know, it was all fairly cheap stuff. And she said, all right, we're going to play a game called the trading game. Now, the first thing I want you to do in this game is I just want you to look at what you've got and look at what everybody else has in the classroom. And I want you to grade what you have between 1 and 10. If you really like your toy, it's a 10. If you hate it, it's a 1. Totally up to you. All right? And so we all did this. We said, okay, now call out the number that you've scored your toy. So we did that, called it out. She added up the total, right? So some person said 2, some 4, some 7. She added up the total and she wrote it on the board. Right, so think of the number as the sort of sum total of how much we evaluated our toy situation or something like that, all right? Got the scenario? All right, so in the first round, she said, okay, in the first round of the game, you can freely trade with anyone else in your row. All right, now I've got to tell you, think of this as 5 rows of 5 to simplify. I didn't count at the time. It was smaller than this. So just imagine 5 rows of 5. That would mean each of us had 4 potential trading partners, right? So there was some trading at this point. Some toys traded hands, some more than once. Wasn't a whole lot of activity. After a couple of minutes, it settled down. And she said, okay, now score how much you like the toy in your hand. So everybody did this again. Some had new toys, some had the same toy, right? We wrote down the numbers. She had us call out the total. We wrote it on the board. Guess what happened? The number went up. Right? Same toys, same classroom, same people. Right? The number went up. Right? So remember that. Now, the second round is the reason I remember this gang. She said, OK, in the second round, you can freely trade with anyone else in the classroom. Okay, so that's 24 potential trading partners on the first trade. And you kind of run the numbers, the network possibilities here. You can't imagine the combinatorial possibilities. So it's total chaos for several minutes. Lots of toys traded hands. Kids that had never spoken the whole year suddenly kind of snapped to attention. Suddenly something interesting happens. That's why I remember this game from the sixth grade, is because of that moment. Finally settled down. And again, she had a score of the toys that we ended up with. Added up the total. She wrote it on the board. You're guessing what happened. The number went up, went way up. Now, what's happening here? All right, well, there's at least seven economic principles that are illustrated by this point. I missed it at the time. I just knew I had to get rid of the Barbie trading cards. I mean, that's sort of, you know, that was my sort of main goal that day. But notice a couple of things. The teacher said you can freely trade with anyone else in the classroom. Does that mean I can threaten a little girl behind me? And I'm going to torment her on the playground if she doesn't hand over her silly putty egg and take my Barbie cards? No. Right? Freely trade means it's free on both sides. So by definition, if I exchange something with you and we exchange and we both know what we're doing, we haven't been lied to or defrauded, that's not going to happen unless we each perceive ourselves as better off as a result. We do this every day. If you go to the grocery store, the grocer is not standing inside the door saying, let's play rock, paper, scissors. If I win, you give me all your money. That's not how it works. I mean, you wouldn't go there twice in any case. You go in, you leave with groceries. That doesn't happen unless you want the groceries more than you wanted the money, and the grocer wanted the money more than he wanted the groceries. So by definition, if it's a genuinely free exchange on both sides, it's win-win. What the trading game did is it set up a system of rules. Think of it as the rule of law. The teacher maintained it. Right? We, all sixth graders, sort of had it partially internalized what the rule of law was. I knew I wasn't supposed to threaten little girls, right? I already knew that. The law written on the heart, right? And I knew I'd get in trouble. I would have gotten swats. This was those days. I would have gotten swats if I had done even something small, right? So there was a rule of law in place. So it constrained what we could do, and then it left us free to exchange with other people in the market, right? Do you see that? So there is a system, there's an economic system and a political economy. And it requires certain basic things. This is, again, not the law of the jungle. This is not anarchy. A free market is not anarchy. A free market is a society with a functioning culture and society and rule of law that is mostly internalized so that most people most of the time don't steal and defraud and murder each other most of the time. Right? You have that. And then you have this domain that gets set up of economic freedom where people can buy and exchange goods and services and information and do it in a mutually beneficial way. That's the essence of free enterprise. So the essence of free enterprise, when it's set up properly, is win-win. It's not a zero-sum game. The final myth is related, but subtly different. We're gonna call it the materialist myth. The materialist myth is a myth about the nature of wealth itself. The materialist myth is the idea that wealth is essentially some material thing. So it's a pot of gold, it's a bunch of cash, it's some property, it's something like that. It's a material thing, and there's a fixed amount of it. So if somebody gets there first and gets more than their fair share, they leave less for the rest of us. All right, so the sort of popular metaphor of this was the pie. You've heard people say this, somebody got more than his fair share, right? More than his share of the pie. Now the nature of a pie, of course, is that it's finite. It's a physical object, particular size, particular volume and mass. And so let's say you make this beautiful pie here and you invite seven friends over. And you really want to eat a fourth of this pie. Are you going to slice yourself a fourth of the pie and then do it in front of your friends? No, you're going to do it beforehand, right? And then you're going to slice up the other pieces and hope that nobody quite notices that the total is just 3/4 of a pie. Now why are you going to do that? Because it is a zero-sum game physically. However much you have, that's less for everyone else. So a physical pie is like this. The best you could do is slice it up into 8 equal slices, and that's what you'll do. Right? If you were to even double your size, that's one fewer piece of the total for everyone else. Right? Does that make sense? So think of that. But this, unlike trade, think of this as the economy as a whole, or the global economy, or all the wealth in the economy, or something like that. Now, the reason that it's tempting to believe this about the economy is that wealth is normally captured and represented by material things, by gold or land or assets or cash or numbers on a ledger. But wealth is actually ultimately just simply, essentially means to ends, right? So if you have a capacity to bring particular ends about, right? Imagine God, for instance, right? Call the entire universe into existence out of nothing, right? God doesn't need to draw from a mine somewhere, right? He's not depleting a resource somewhere. So that's this kind of ultimate access. But for physical beings in the material world, the wealthier a person is economically, the more means to ends they have, they can achieve ends. And the wealthier an economy has, the less it has to put in and the more that it can get out. So you can think about the sort of particle transformer on Star Trek, right? Captain Jean-Luc Picard, he just says, Earl Grey hot, and it just appears, right? So that's an amazing type of wealth to be able to actually do that, right? But most people know this isn't what the economy is like. If you look at actual economies throughout the 20th century, even the global economy, include sub-Saharan Africa in that. There are depressions and recessions, but economies in general, market economies, they get bigger over the time. Per capita income, total size of the economy, almost anything you want to count, goes up. It doesn't go down. And countries that trade with each other, incidentally, are the ones that do better. The ones that don't do well are usually the ones that are shut out of trade. So who believes this? Well, believe it or not, for most of the 20th century, half the human race was subject to an experiment based upon a theory that viewed the economy in exactly that way. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels wrote the book, it's a little pamphlet really, called The Communist Manifesto in 1848. They're, by the way, the ones that popularized the word capitalism. You will not find the word in Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations. You will not find it on the lips of any American founder. Capitalism was a pejorative term popularized by socialists to describe the economy in Western Europe and the United States at the time. All right, so that's just by the by. So the word capitalism is always kind of problematic for that reason. But here's their prediction. Because they describe, Marx is in an apartment in London writing this, and he is thinking about the factories in England at the time, textile factories and things like that. And he divided up populations into these classes. And the main two classes were the capitalists or the bourgeoisie. These are the guys that owned the wealth, so the money and the capital, that is the equipment and the factories. They own stuff. And then the proletariat or laboring class, and so those are the people that are paid an hourly or a daily wage to work in the factories or on the farms, but don't own the equipment, all right? So you can think of this as a sort of 1% to the 99% image. All right, so here's what Marx and Engels predicted in the Communist Manifesto. So look at this, I want you to look at this pie chart here, but this represents not the populations themselves. The different segments represent the amount of wealth in the economy in the hands of different classes. All right, so let's say this is 1750. And initially, the laborers, who are the vast majority of the population, let's say that's about 70% of the wealth. So the laborers initially, before industrialization started, have about 70% of the wealth in the economy. And then the capitalists are kind of the light blue, they have about 20%. All right, and then there's some others divided up that we'll ignore. Right, so it starts out with the workers with the majority of the wealth and the capitalists with a minority. Well, here's what Marx and Engels say will happen, is that over time what capitalists do is they'll, let's say you have a textile factory, you hire a bunch of workers to help you make the shirts that you're gonna make, and then you take the shirts to market and you try to sell them for more than they cost to produce. So maybe every shirt costs you a pound a shirt and you sell it for a pound and 10. So you make a little bit of profit. So the profit you make above how much it costs to produce is what Marx called the surplus value. Marx had this screw idea that something is only worth as much as it costs to produce it. So if the capitalist sells it for more, he is exploiting the worker and the customer. So that's called a surplus value. But Marx said, but he's not gonna squander this extra profit, the surplus value. He's gonna reinvest it in equipment. So he'll buy a new steam engine or power generator, something to make his workers more productive. Now they're more productive, so he can fire some, he can pay the rest even less, and they'll be even more productive, and then he can sell the shirts, it cost him less, he can sell them for more, and now he's made even more profit. And again, he reinvests it, so he continues this process. Marx said, through this capitalist process, of kind of increased efficiency, the wealth of the economy is going to get transferred from the laborers, again in the red, to the capitalists. And there will be fewer and fewer capitalists because they'll merge and drive each other out of business. You'll end up with three really rich monopolists owning everything. So think of that as five guys own that much of the economy, and 99% of the population is in the red. So what happens at this stage? Revolution. Marx says, this is inevitably what's going to happen. And then at this point, the proletariats, the workers, rise up, confiscate the means of production, liquidate the capitalists, kill them. And then there's a new stage called the socialist stage, in which the state owns everything on behalf of the people. But this is just a temporary stage, Marx thought. Right? This is what socialism, yes, it's gray, but that's what it looks like. All right. So there is no private property. State owns everything. And then a new socialist man will emerge that's not attached to possessions. And then at that point, the socialist state will collapse. It will disappear, will wither away, and everyone will live in a communist utopia where they have everything they need, everything they want. They can fish in the mornings, and they can hunt in the afternoons and read in the evenings. This is what he thought. He thought socialism was just a temporary stage. So if you want to know why so many nice people supported the Soviet Union, even ones that lived there, it wasn't because they thought the Soviet Union was the end. They thought it was a means to get to this communist utopia that was still to come. It never came. Never worked. Now, why didn't it work? It didn't work because everything Marx said about what capitalism does was false, was known to be false at the time. He didn't know it. 2 miles away, when he was writing the Communist Manifesto, the wages of workers in textile factories were going up in England, not down. That directly contradicted his theory. That would have been impossible based upon his assumption, right? But the theory was this kind of self-contained philosophy that just stated what had to be true about the economy, not what was actually true, because he did not exercise that virtue I talked about at the beginning. He did not exercise the art of economics, in which he focused on what the economy and economic reality is actually like. So about 100 million people or so died as a result of the experiment. What's the market reality? It's not anything like that. It's not utopia. Obviously, not everyone ends up equally well off. There are, in the short run, often winners and losers that we have to take account of. Nevertheless, the market reality is this. Market reality is that the pie grows. I know you're thinking this isn't the greatest animation I've ever seen. Bear with me here. This is the best I could do. You see the point, though, right? What's the point? If the pie can grow, then it's possible for someone to get fabulously wealthy in a market economy, not by confiscating wealth from someone else, but by participating in a process of wealth creation. The late Steve Jobs did not get rich stealing iPads from homeless people, right? It's just not how it worked. I lived in Seattle. Even the homeless people that came to our church for the soup kitchen had iPods, strangely enough. And that only happens in a market economy. Right? Steve Jobs, he wasn't even a really good guy. He was kind of, not an especially virtuous guy, but he was very good at anticipating the needs and the wants of customers. So what you want is an economic system that's fit for us as fallen human beings, that allows us to channel our ingenuity and our legitimate self-interest and even our vices into things that are beneficial to other people, and that allows us to create wealth and to create value for others. And here, I'm just going to make a brief theological point at the end, because if you think that human beings are a unique hybrid of the material and the spiritual, so we're not just ghosts trapped in bodies, right? And we're not just glorified apes, but we're creatures made in the image and the likeness of the creative God. Right? If you have some kind of view of the human person, it's like this. You should expect something like this to be true, that God can create the universe and then create beings in his image. God creates the sand. He leaves it to us to create fiber optic cables and computer chips based on silica. Right? The reality is that human beings are able to transform matter into resources, creating wealth that was not there before. And so what we should want for ourselves and our fellow human beings is an economy that's best suited to allow us to do just this. Thank you very much. We have a few minutes for questions.
Just a couple questions.
And so everybody that wants to ask a question needs to come to the mic, though, because we're streaming and recording. I'll give short answers. You don't believe me. I know. Yeah.
What would you say in response to someone like Ayn Rand who relates Christianity and communism like so closely and directly?
Yeah. So Rand's, I talk a bit about this in the book, and if you actually just Google my name and Ayn Rand, you'll find a bunch of articles on this. The funny thing is, if you think the people that actually tried to implement socialism, there were some kind of social, Robert Owens, and there were kind of these socialist Christian experiments, but they're all voluntary and they all failed. If you look at the actual people that tried to implement Soviet communism, for instance, it was a decidedly atheistic philosophy. I mean, Marxism is based on dialectical materialism. So just a simple historical point, it just simply wasn't true, this idea that somehow there's this family relationship between Christianity and socialism. I mean, socialism, as it actually became manifest in the 20th century. So what, in this case, I'm talking about Marxist socialism. And a very specific set of beliefs. None of them were specific to Christianity. And if you, on the other hand, if you look at, I wouldn't say, if you read the Bible or the Christian tradition, you can't get all the details of economics, obviously. At least I would say the biblical narrative is completely hostile to socialism, and it presupposes the existence of private property. Two of the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not covet, presuppose the legitimacy of private property. One of the 50 chapters of Genesis. So here's the book of the Bible that starts at the beginning of the universe and ends with Joseph, you know, in what, you know, 1500 BC in Egypt. That's a huge amount of time. One full chapter of that book is dedicated to Abraham negotiating for the price of a field to buy to bury his wife. And it's this detailed kind of property negotiation. So I just think factually and historically it's not true. And if you just actually look at how socialism worked its way out in the 20th century, it doesn't have any kind of family relationship to Christianity. In fact, it was always viciously hostile. And Lenin himself, it was family and religion that he saw as the ultimate enemies to that. So I just think historically she's simply not right. I also think she made a mistake in not understanding the nature of altruism. There's a type of there's entrepreneurial altruism in which you can invent something and profit from it and benefit from it and also benefit from other people. In fact, I would argue most successful entrepreneurs in market economies, if you're just focused on yourself, trust me, an entrepreneur that's just literally fixated on himself is not going to succeed. He might be wanting to get rich, but good entrepreneurs are fixated on some vision that they want to bring about, this thing they want to create, and they put their own wealth at risk. So I think Rand just kind of got this wrong. I think George Gilder in Wealth and Poverty is a thinker that I think understands entrepreneurial capitalism better than Rand. Good
Thank
question.
You.
You bet.
Hi. Professor Richards, you said at the beginning of your lecture talk that you were a philosopher.
Yes.
All right, I'm going to tap into okay. some of the philosophical character.
That's always dangerous. Sorry.
Character.
Okay, we may run out the clock. Sorry.
So we are in an age where artificial intelligence
yes.
and automation and robots are on the brink of something big and
yeah.
unexpected.
Right.
Do you think that there's a possibility with this rise in technology and technological advancement and artificial intelligence that we may come to a point where human labor is not really necessary and where a basic livable income
right.
or say a communist utopia arises.
Yeah, and that's where the action is right now. In fact, I'm giving a lecture at Yale tomorrow and moderating a debate on automation, by the way. And so you don't know this. This was not a setup, right? So I have a book coming out in 2 months on this. That's what the human advantage is about. So I do not think, we're at the sort of cusp of a major disruption that I think will be more significant than the disruption from the agrarian to the industrial switch. So a major inflection point. We are just at the beginning of it. People don't quite realize that. So we still don't. Amazon has automated factories that can do everything but remove products from conveyor belts and put them in boxes. So something that every three-year-old can do with his arm, we don't have robots that can do that yet. We'll eventually get that. It's a kind of a long and complicated story, but I would say, first of all, I'm not saying read the book, but that's kind of the only way to get the arguments. We are not going to reach a stage, I do not believe, in which human activity and labor broadly construed will ever be obsolete. And the reason is because machines are fundamentally different than we are. What we are going to create is more and more complex machines that do more and more of what we thought only we could do. And that will require us to focus on the human advantage, on what our comparative advantage is, different from machines. And so don't expect a utopia where we have nothing to do. That actually sounds like a dystopia to me. because I think it's our nature to work. And so this is the whole literature on automation and robotics. One half of it says machines are going to do everything, they're going to steal all the jobs, and it's going to be terrible. The other half is the machines are going to do everything, we won't have to do it, it'll be terrific. I think both of those are ultimately kind of dystopian pictures. I think what's going to happen is that machines, automation and things like that will happen simultaneously with actually different preferences. So at the beginning of the 20th century, half the population worked on farms. At the time of the American founding, 95% of the population worked on farms. Today it's less than 1%. Is there anyone in the room who lives and works on a farm? Representative sample. We don't have 100 kids here, one or two of you. That's actually higher than normal. What's going to happen, I mean, already in Europe, there's a massive farm built of tarps, monitored by drones, almost entirely automated with hydroponic farming. 10 years from now, that whole thing will be automated. That doesn't mean there aren't going to also be small farms, because what's happening? In every city in the country, people want local produce grown. They want to know the name of the farmer, right? And so what's actually going to happen is as the price of different goods gets close to zero, our preferences change. So as the cost of a cup of coffee from Dairy Queen goes to 2 cents and then 1 cent, we get more and more fussy about the particularities of the kind of latte we want. So that's what I predict we should expect. So if you're in college, you're about to go to college, you need to train yourself to prepare for this kind of economy. And my argument would be that you want to develop both a broad liberal arts education and also develop a specialty. Because whatever the specialty is, it's going to be obsolete in 10 or 15 years, but it's helpful to do philosophy and literature, politics, and also accounting. So, yeah, you're right, I gave a long answer, sorry about that. So, but we have time for one more. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
You bet.
I also wanted to ask a question about philosophy. So in Cicero's philosophical treatise on duties, he addresses the purported contention between what is beneficial and what is expedient. Mm-hmm. And he uses the arguments of Diogenes and Antipater. And he says that that what is beneficial to the seller should also be beneficial to the buyer.
Right.
And how does that kind of relate to what Rand's argument was? That you should, even at self-detriment to the seller, you should still consult the benefit of the buyer.
Well, and so here's Smith's argument. So Cicero there is assuming, he's actually, there's kind of a bit of a zero-sum game assumption in his thinking that you're probably detecting there, right? That, okay, if the seller is looking out for his interest, then he's going to probably want to rip off the customer, right? Now, in a monopoly situation, right, that's what happens. That could happen. Assume, you know, everybody's kind of fallen. And so if you're the one little mom and pop store and the closest place where anybody can get milk is 100 miles away, they have to buy from you, that's going to set up a series of incentives, right? Mm-hmm. Where you're going to want to, okay, I want to make as much as I can, and I also don't have to be that good, right? I can overcharge, right? Because, I mean, unless they're going to drive 100 miles, they're going to buy my milk, right? This is how Walmart succeeded. As lots of little towns with little monopoly shops like that, they moved in and undercut them, right? In a competitive environment, it's not like that at all. So if I have a gas station and there are three other gas stations in the other parts of the intersection, I might want to charge twice as much and force people to pay. I can't do that though, can I? I could do it once. See, I'm going to just charge twice as much as the market price for gas. Nobody's going to buy from me. I could put some water in with the gas, right? I might work a couple of times and word would quickly get out, right? On the internet, and you go broke. And so that's his point, is that in a market economy with the rule of law and competition, it's going to orient people so that they can be focusing on either their legitimate self-interest or they could even be kind of wanting to defraud you. But they're going to be incentivized to do something that's of benefit to other people. That's Smith's point. And so I think Smith understands the details a little better than Cicero did. And these insights, you get Spanish scholastics that understand this. And so when Adam Smith writes this book in 1776, he's read all these scholastic philosophers and churchmen and schoolmen who have been analyzing the nature of property and sales. And so he kind of puts it together a little bit better. So that's why I spent so much time on Smith, is I think his argument's really important. That's a great, great point, though. Thanks for the question. Good question. All right, thanks so much.